same God yesterday, today, and forever. The one that is and was and shall forever be. The Lord God, our helper. The Lord God, the lift up of our heads. The Lord God, our glory. The Lord God, our support. The Lord God, our succor. The Lord God, our forgiver. The Lord God, our righteousness. The Lord God, our justifier. The Lord God, our sanctifier. The Lord God, our purifier. The lift up of our heads. Our glory. Our supplier, our provider, the eternal of ages, the guarantor of our salvation, the guarantor of our tomorrow, our help in ages past, our hope for the years to come. We worship you, mighty Father. We bless you, ancient of days. We lift up your name, O God. Your name is wonderful. Counselor, the mighty God, the everlasting Father. You are the Prince of Peace, the God that you cannot see, but we see the works of his hands, invisible, always invisible. Awesome Redeemer, Gentile Redeemer, awesome ruler. We celebrate you, Lord. We celebrate you. The one that is Babylon in splendor. You are gathered in praises. You are the Father of light. You are the God of light. You dwell in light, no one can approach unto. You dwell in light, no one can approach unto. We bless you, mighty Father. The heavens declare your glory. The firmament show your active work. Day to day, the altar speaks. Night to night, the revealed knowledge. You are the God of generations. You are the God of all flesh. You are the unchangeable changer. 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 You are the God of miracles, signs, and wonders. You are the God of miracles, signs, and wonders. You are the God of miracles, signs, and wonders. We worship you, mighty Father. As a church, we praise you. As a church, we celebrate you. As a church, we honor you. As a church, we give you your place. We give you your rightful place of abode. As a church, oh God, we ask you to come down. Help us this morning in the mighty name of Jesus. Take your rightful place in our midst. Lord, take your rightful place in our midst. Lord, take your rightful place in our midst. Lift bodies this morning. Lord, miracles this morning. Let your word, oh God, bless us this morning. Let your word transform. Let your word change us, oh mighty Father. And let your name alone be exalted. We give you praise. We give you praise. We give you praise. We give you praise. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. A round of applause for Jesus. A round of applause. A round of applause. A round of applause. Glory, 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 glory. Amen. You may please be seated while the children and their teachers, teenagers, go downstairs. Please, all children, teachers, you are to meet with the pastor after the service. All children, teachers, at the conference room downstairs, please make sure you around to meet with the pastor. All children, teachers, God bless you as you go. We truly appreciate you. Come on, let's give them a round of applause. Let's give them a round of applause. The teachers, the children, we celebrate you. We bless God for your life. We bless God for you all. Come on, let's keep clapping as they go downstairs. Let's keep clapping. Let's keep clapping as they go downstairs. Amen and amen and amen and amen. Just to remind you that all of us have a duty, an obligation to this church. Just that the church has an obligation towards you to pray for you, to teach you the word. I'm sure you also know, as a member of this church, you have an obligation to the church. One of such is to support the church financially. Another is also to bring someone to church. This year, we are believing God that you will reproduce yourself in church. Amen. In other words, you will bring someone that will remain in church. Amen. You will watch over them, ensure they remain in church. This is what gladdens the heart of God. People need to belong to a church family. People need to hear the word of God. The word of God changes lives. And the word of God preached is different from the word of God read. I'm sure you know that. When the preaching is going on, anointing accompanies the word. And God does something with the word that is preached. So God bless you as you collaborate with God, as you do your bits, as you do your best. As you do your bits, the work of God will progress. Amen. As you do your best, the work of God will get better. Amen. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Don't worry about the seats. Don't worry about, when the seat is full, we find a way out, you know. But just do your bits. And the Lord will bless you for doing your bit in Jesus' mighty name. This morning, we actually asked you last week to give us questions that borders on marriage. But it was just this morning, I just got two questions this morning. It was late. We were checking the website, checking the email of the church. We announced again on Wednesday. Amen. We announced again on Wednesday, there was no response. But so I just, in my own way, I just felt, well, let's still talk about marriage. So money is a very important issue in marriage. We will talk about money. Communication is another very important issue in marriage. And of course, romance. The African man is very romantic. And the earlier he knows that romance is a part of marriage, the better for him. Amen. I'm changing. This morning, it's possible I'm preaching to myself. You know, but God will help us in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5 is a place we all know. But the more we read this thing, the better we become. I told you that anything left to itself, you know, is bound to go stale. Life, the natural course in life, that if you leave something to itself, it goes bad. If you leave a building to itself without touching it again and again, it depreciates. If you leave your body unchecked, believe me, it also goes bad. So marriage is also the same. You know, marriage has to be worked on for you to get better. Marriage has to be worked on for you to improve. So that's why we have to talk about marriage in church. And because even now as a church, we have to make a case for marriage. Because the world is making us feel marriage is not important anymore. I mean, people who have the media, they're telling us you can cohabit. There's no need for marriage, no need for commitment anymore. You can be living lovers, doesn't matter. You know, so now more than ever before, the church has to make a strong case for marriage. Because what we see around us is not encouraging at all. Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 21. The Bible says, Ephesians chapter 5 verse 21, submitting to one another in the fear of God. Ephesians 5, 21, verse 22, wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is head of the wife, as also Christ is head of the church. He's the savior of the body. As of, this is echoing, please help us. Verse 24, therefore just as the church is subject to Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word. Verse 27, that he might present how to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. So husbands ought to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself, for no one ever entered his own flesh. God bless you, sir. Please put it back to what it used to be before. I'm sorry, you know, please. For nourishes and cherishes it, just as the Lord does the church. For we are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and shall be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. Nevertheless, let each of you in particular so love his own wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband. You know, familiarity with contents. When you are familiar with something, if care is not taken, you may lose the value of that thing. We are so familiar with the scriptures. You know, this is one passage even me I'm familiar with. And if care is not taken for us to go back home and read it quietly, we'll actually lose the value of this scripture. It's clear, husband love your wife, wife submit to your own husbands. And if you do that, peace will reign in the home, peace will reign in the community. And the case for marriage is that God actually started marriage. Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. Say, God said it's not good for the man to be alone. I will make him a helpmeet. Amen? I will make him a help suitable for him. So if God started marriage, it's the manufacturer of marriage. And believe me, the best authority in marriage, the best person who can speak about marriage is not up now. Because he's not even married in the first place. And she's confusing a whole bunch. The best person that can speak for marriage is the Bible. It's God himself. This is God's authority. So when God says, submit to one another in the fear of the Lord, is a serious matter. When God says, wife, submit to your husband as unto the Lord, not if the man is respectable, says, submit to your husband as unto, so as you submit to your husband, you are submitting to the Lord. So if you disobey that man, you are disobeying the Lord. It's there, Ephesians chapter 5, verse 23. You can check other verses. So he said, husband, he said, wife, submit to your husband as unto the Lord. Not give the man his body of respect. And so on and so forth. So, Marriage is God's creation, is God's idea, is God's initiative. So the best person that can talk about marriage is God. Another case about marriage is that God wants a godly heritage. Malachi chapter 2, verses 14 to 16. Malachi chapter 2, verse 14 to 15. God says that witness between you and the wife of your youth. Say, you did treacherously with the wife of your youth. He says, look, I will not be happy with you. He went on to say, God hates divorce. And why does God hate divorce? Because God wants a godly heritage. That's why God hates divorce. Divorce impacts negatively on society. Children that come forth from divorced homes are different from children who come from settled homes. It's a fact. God says, I hate divorce because divorce would breed, it would truncate my plan of having a godly heritage. It's there. Malachi chapter 2, verse 14 to 16. Malachi 2, verse 14 to 16. So this day is so shocking. When even in church, you see pastors who have been married four times. Amen. It's so shocking. So God says, I hate it. And when God says, I hate something, you better hate it with him. Because if God says, if you love what God hates, that is trouble. It will haunt you later, sometime in the future. So a godly marriage means godly children. And it also impacts positively on the society. We have all this craziness going on because people are not from solid homes. There's no stability emotionally for many children because of what they see their parents, because of divorce, because of fighting, conflict in the home. So children go out, they're not stable emotionally. So for the sake of your children, please, let this thing work. For the sake of your future, let this thing work. And when we were growing up, I had my mother say several times, you hear women saying, growing up in Africa, that because of my children, that's why I'm in this marriage. And you know, the reality of life is that something that is hot today, believe me, if you stay with it, it will become cold tomorrow. Nothing is hot all around. So women who endure their marriage, I saw that happen to my mom. In 1983, we were out of the country, we were vacationing, we were in Italy, Israel, and so on and so forth. My whole family, my father, my mother, myself, and one of my younger siblings. At 1981, I beg your pardon, I was just about 15 years old, 14 or 15 years old, and my parents fought all through that period. My father told my mom, when I get back to Nigeria, I'm divorcing you. I had it. Not that I had it. They got back to Nigeria, the woman kept on enduring. By the time my father died in 83, if you see what he wrote in his will concerning his wife, that if not, that this woman is priceless, this is my treasure, this is my... So what am I saying? Whatever is hot today will become cold tomorrow. So if you throw your marriage into the shambles because you have friends who are doing that, you are going to injure yourself in times to come. You may lose your children in the process if you don't allow reason to prevail. So marriage is to be honored. The Bible says that Hebrews chapter 13 verse 4. Say marriage should be honored, it should be respected. Say the marriage should be undefiled because God will judge adulterers and whoremongers. So marriage is a respectable institution because God actually started it. And when you honor what God honors, God will honor you. But when you disregard what God honors, he will also likely esteem you. 1 Samuel chapter 2 verse 13. So because God honors marriage, every child of God should also respect marriage. The world today do not respect marriage anymore. That's why people enter marriage with the mind of living marriage. In this church, they teach us, that there's only one door to marriage, is the entry door. Once you enter, there's no exit. That's what they teach us in this church. I'm not lying to you. That's what this church upholds. As a matter of fact, a couple of years now, you know what this church did? This church said anybody who has been, who is married, from henceforth, any pastor, that was about 2 years ago, the law was passed, that any pastor in this church who wants to divorce and remarry should please just go. It was a law written down. So if you are becoming a pastor in RCCG and you know, look, I want to divorce, just go now. There's no. And the church actually was a big risk because the church says no divorce, at least in pastor level. Because whatever God honors, as a child of God, must honor it. When you see something is respectable, something should be respected, then we should respect it. But what we see in society today, there is no respect for marriage anymore. Another case for marriage is that when marriage is united, when there is unity between husband and wife, it commands tremendous blessings. You see, Satan knows, which is why he's attacking marriage in the church. When you see a husband and wife, when they are together indeed, you know, they are sleeping on the same, they are both facing north. It's not as if one is facing north and the other one is facing south. When they are together united, oh God, God blesses such union. Psalm 23, verse 1 to 3. He says, it is good for brethren to dwell together in unity. He went on to say that it's like the anointing that flows from the head down to the beard and then to the skirt of Aaron. And then he goes on to say that there, when there's unity there, God commands his blessings. Amen? So when God sees that a church, a family is united as one, he commands blessings. And let me tell you, the church is losing big time blessings because husband and wife are not together. All this prayer jargons, you know, we can pray, but the Bible says to obey is better than sacrifice. When we pray, we make sacrifice. The sacrifice that matters is the sacrifice that is backed with obedience. So if you are praying, you are being night vigil, you still beat your wife, you still abuse her verbally, you still abuse her physically, for God's sake, your prayer is just nothing. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 7, says, husband, dwell with them according to knowledge, that your prayers be not hindered. The reason why I beg my wife at times when she's not happy is because I don't want my prayers to be hindered. I don't want my heavens to be sealed up. The reason why at times when I know I'm in the right, I have to bend over backwards, even though I'm in the right, I still say sorry, is because I don't want my heavens to be shut. Say, husband, dwell with them by knowledge, that your prayers be not hindered. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 7. So when a family is together, united, the Bible says that God commands his blessings. Two are better than one because they have a better reward for their labor. Say, if two of you shall agree, that too is husband and wife. If you shall agree over any matter here, it shall be done by a father who is in heaven. That's how powerful, you know, a couple who is together as one, that's how powerful they can be. And Satan knows it, which is why he's fighting tooth and nail. When my prayer over your marriage, over your life, Satan would be ashamed in the mighty name of Jesus. Over your offspring, Satan would be ashamed in the mighty name of Jesus. Another case for marriage is that God uses marriage to perfect us. And this is very, very, very big. I mean, he described marriage as the union between Christ and the church. And as we are joined to the church, as we are joined to Christ, we are being perfected. So, believe me, marriage, God uses marriage to perfect people. When I first gave my life to Christ, when I just yelled a bit about my wife, and when we first got married, I'm sorry, when I just raised my voice a bit on her, she would start crying. She would cry. These days, after 1 year of doing that, she stopped crying. I haven't seen my wife cry in many, many years. Even when the father died, she was just said a few tears, and that was it. So marriage rubs off on you. I am a very temperamental person. God is helping me now. I mean, my hunger can fear. I'm just telling you the truth. God is helping me big time. But I married a woman that is so stable emotionally. When she's angry, her voice doesn't go up. And she's affected. When she's angry, her voice doesn't go. Her voice never goes up. You don't see her yelling and screaming and, you know, in uncontrollable rage. It never happens. So every time when I'm angry and I'm screaming and she's looking at me, I feel like a stupid guy. I look like a fool. So gradually, you don't see me yelling anymore. When I begin to do it, I catch myself because of the woman I'm living with. So God intends marriage to perfect you, to fine-tune you, to smoothen you. And when you don't allow that process to go, when you don't allow that process to happen, you may not be careful. Some people will not be careful because of marriage. It's not a cause, it's just a truth. And some people will be careful because of marriage. So God intends marriage to perfect. So if you are looking for a perfect, sinless, perfected guy to marry, you you wait in eternity. Or if you are looking for a woman who is just all an angel, you know, you want to marry an angel. You want to marry an angel, you will wait forever because there's no such thing. So God's plan is that marriage will perfect, that your spouse will rub off on you, and you will rub off on your spouse, and together you'll be smoothed and be made ready even for the coming of the Lord. It's my prayer you'll be made ready for the coming of the Lord in the mighty name of Jesus. Now, another area that marriage will test you is the area of forgiveness. And this is the, you see, the only way to get to heaven is on the platform of forgiveness. If your sins are not forgiven, there's no heaven. In other words, if the blood of Jesus does not avail for you, for your sins to be forgiven, there's no heaven. The only platform anyone will get to heaven is on the platform of forgiveness. Which is why God says, if anyone offends you, forgive. But there's no better place that is put to test than in marriage. Somebody said, marriage is not just a union of great lovers, but it's a union of great forgivers. Amen? It's not just a union of great lovers, but a union of great forgivers. If you see a couple of them for 40 years, you are seeing two guys, two people who are great forgivers. You are seeing two people who are, because things could have happened in their past, that somebody has chosen to forgive, and that's the nature of God. That's the way we demonstrate love. So if I truly love you, I will forgive you. If I truly love you, I will cover your sins. If I truly love you, I will not keep on recounting 10 years down the line of how you threw me out of the house. I will let go and let God if I truly love. Because a big part of love is forgiveness. When there's no forgiveness, there's no love. So God chooses to forgive you because he loves you. And it's on that platform you will all make heaven. But if you refuse to forgive your spouse, and that's the person who offended you the greatest, mind you, is the person you live with, that you sleep with, that you talk to, that you get together, that's your neighbor that will offend you the most. I mean, not someone I see once in a year, you know, is the person I'm with. So the true test of marriage is actually your forgiving your spouse. That's another area that marriage fine-tunes. Marriage, you know, smoothens us. It makes us ready for the coming of the Lord. So at times, marriage is not just rosy. Amen? That's why there are ups and downs. You know, marriage is not meant to make you totally comfortable. It's also there to help you smoothen out your rough edges. Now, the foundation for a successful marriage, very, very key. You see, it's not every divorce that is because somebody did something wrong. Some divorces happen because of a wrong choice of partner. Believe me. So the foundation for every successful marriage is number one, to pick rightly, to choose rightly. To choose rightly, that's the foundation. As a matter of fact, when I was growing up in Africa, it was a norm. If you want to marry any girl, you bring her home. The first thing my parents will ask you in Africa is, look, where is she from? Who are the parents? And they will go investigate. There's no story. They will investigate. It's the norm. But you know, in America, people, when I say, Pastor, we just got married. I'm telling you, that means this is how you think I'm joking? And they will go marry, there's no family impute, no pastor, no church impute. They will just say, Pastor, oh, for information, we are married. That's America for me. A young girl, many years back in this church, you know, I so much cherished her. I mean, I just liked her for who she was. She brought this guy to church and said, Pastor, that's my guy. I said, okay, this is okay. So I was interrogating the guy. I said, where do you live? Which church do you go to? Oh, when she told me the church, I said, I know your pastor. I will give your pastor a call just to find out about you. Say, as a matter of fact, I just go once in a while. I'm not too regular. This church I actually go to. He began to change his story. He began to lie. So I pressed again. Many things I was asking him, he couldn't answer me. You know what? The next thing was that this lady went to meet my wife and said I was harassing the guy. So I left her. Because you see, I can only correct somebody who wants to be corrected. That's the job of a pastor. If you refuse to be under my authority, I can't help you. So she told my wife, like, pastor is crossing his line, is affecting, is bugging my boyfriend.
So I said, okay. Long story short, they got married. As you didn't even know. 3 months into the marriage, the thing packed up. The guy danced with her. He was big dealing with her. Why am I saying this? Brethren, the successful way, so the foundation of marriage is what? Is thinking like. There are many cowboys in the church today. I don't know why the men, young men, are not just born again. When I see a few of them who are actually born again, I thank God. But even those who are born again, they are not serious. And it's a worrisome issue. You don't see young men in churches anymore. I don't know where they are. I don't know what they are doing. And they now come and they begin to lie to young girls and they deceive them. Back in Africa, where I'm coming from, you don't go to a girl in church to tell her, I love you, I want to marry you. You have to come through the pastor, come through the church to go tell her. In other words, if you see a sister you like, you come and say, Pastor, oh, I like sister so and so, please, what do you think about it? Because there are so many cowboys. By the time you pastor a church of 2,000 people, and then you see a guy talking to 4 girls at the same time. So that's why the church in our wisdom says, let us sanitize this thing. Let's sanitize it. But America is different. You even talk to someone, boyfriend, please. They say, oh, you are crossing your line. And now, immediately, when the lady gets hot, guess what? So it is wisdom. When we say, check out, when we investigate wisdom, you know, when I say cowboys, these are boys that are not born again. When I say cowboys, these are guys that they don't want any authority figure over them. No, they don't want the church to interfere. As a matter of fact, I've seen it happen over and over again. I said, look, somebody brings a guy to church. Oh, come visit us in the house. A lady, come visit us in the house. That's the last we see them. They won't come. Before you know it, they're broken up. You see, the guys of this day should realize that you can't force your way into marriage. I'm telling you. You can't. It's better to remain single than to end up in a bad marriage. If God doesn't open that door of marriage for you, if you try to force it open by yourself, you will get burnt. By faith and patience, they obtain the promises. Don't say your biological clock is ticking and you can't wait anymore, and you allow one lousy boy to mess you up. Be patient. You will marry. God will make it happen. Have faith. Develop yourself spiritually. You know, cultivate yourself spiritually and trust God. You can always tell when a boy is a cowboy. The signs are there. He doesn't love your God. He doesn't care about your God. He has no authority figure over him. And you see, you open your eyes and you enter fire. The world is enough for the wise. And all the cowboys in the house, God will give them a change heart in Jesus. Amen. They will repent in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. And you young ladies, please, don't be in a hurry. Don't push yourself. There are good guys, godly guys. They are there. Those who are born again, born for the Lord. Amen. Go for them. You will see them. It's not all about this fine boy syndrome. Amen. I'm telling you, you know, you can help your husband to become a fine boy. And you see, when you start making money, money makes everybody fine. When you have good money, you become fine. So don't get caught up in, hey, he has to be this height, oh, he has to be this slim, he has to be macho, he has to be, for God's sake. At times, the finer they have, the more dangerous they have. I'm telling you. Let me run from this way, don't. Please forgive me, help us. So, well, 3 issues in marriage, which is very critical, and the first one is communication. Amen. It's true that many marriages break because of communication. When an old man and wife stops talking to each other, the trouble is brewing. It's a serious matter. As a matter of fact, when the woman is wired, if you don't talk to a woman, that's the easiest way to kill her. And if women don't like to be ignored, and every man must know that. Talk to your wife. The Bible says, you know, that Jesus refreshes the church by the washing of water. You know, he talks to us even when he's rebuking. He's doing it in love. So we are getting better because we are being cherished. I mean, we are getting better because of the word of the Lord. So please, communication is very, very critical. And what is communication? It's interchange of thoughts, opinions and information by speech, by sign, and by writing. It's the change, the interchange of thoughts and opinions and information by speech, by sign, and by writing. Without communication, there's no understanding. Without communication, there's no appreciation. Amen. In other words, we can communicate with signs and with even without talking. And I know it when my wife is angry. When I'm doing something on the other, I'm not sure, I just look at her, and I can tell just by her countenance. And that will tell me, don't go there. I mean, it's communication. At times, you don't have to talk. I mean, those people who are growing up, you go out with your parents, they look at just one look, you can tell, no, don't do that anymore. It's communication. It's communication. So, what are the principles of effective communication? Because for conflict to be resolved in the house, you have to communicate. And there are bound to be conflicts. One of such is the choice of the tone. I just told you about yelling. There is a soft answer turns away wrath. Amen? When you answer softly, he has a way of just cooling tempers. He also went on to say that, you know, a harsh voice tears up anger. Proverbs 15 verse 1. A harsh voice tears up anger. So even the tone that you talk with matters a lot. When you yell at your children, yell at your wife, you know, you are telling them you are the domineering kind of father. It's not good. You don't yell at your wife. You don't raise your voice at your wife. You don't do it. It's not to be done. It's not something that can come down. So, some assumptions are very wrong. And the Bible goes on to say that same Proverbs 15, 1 and verse 2. Say, the tongue of the wise uses knowledge rightly, but the mouth of fools pours forth foolishness. That's big. Say, the tongue of the wise uses knowledge rightly, but the mouth of fools pours forth foolishness. There's what we call creative communication. You can talk to someone, you know, with wisdom. And that was what Nabal did when God told him David had sinned. David committed adultery, committed murder. And Nabal, the pastor, the prophet, was going to go to the king. But he couldn't tell the king point blank, you're a goner. So what did he do? He created a poem, I mean, he created a proverb. I mean, he created something. There was this poor man who had just one goat, and there was this big man, this very rich man who had a herd of lambs, who had, you know, so many. And they were living next to each other, and then one day this rich man had a visitor, and the visitor came, and rather than the rich man to just take one out of the several goats that he had, he just went to pick the one goat the poor man had, and smack it from him, you know, and you know the rest of the story. And David said, oh, who is that man? I will deal with him. I will kill him. And the prophet said, you are the one. So they said, you can creatively communicate. When there's conflict, the choice of tone matters. When there's conflict, creative. You can be creative. When there's conflict, even your choice of words. Some Christians still say bastard. I'm telling you, you'll be surprised. They still call stupid, foolish, idiots. Christian. And I'm not lying. Still saying, we call idiot, stupid. These are abusive words, a child of God. The Bible says, let your speech be always with grace. So let it be seasoned with salt, that you may know how you want to answer each one. Brethren, words are powerful. Words create the future. It is people go to war just by announcing, just by speaking. And things happen with words. So you have to be careful the way you use your words. You know, some marriages, when you go, when they have issues, and you go try to sort it out, you'll be seeing the wife recounting what the husband did 10 years ago. And she'll be telling you in details. In my place, they say words are like heck. And once it goes out and it breaks, that's the end of it. You can't put it together anymore. So whatever thing that you don't want to say, please don't think it. Because in anger, even if you think it at all, you will say it in anger. Even when you're angry, control yourself. You can walk away. My uncle taught me when I'm angry, count up to 1, 5. And by the time you count up to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the anger will come there a little bit. Count another 5. And that's a strategy. So don't always react. Because when you speak, it's gone forth. And to to redress what you spoke of, you know, you damage can be done recklessly. Communication, concentrate on issues, not personalities. And this is very, very key for those of us who oversee people in a secular. Concentrate on issues. The issue at hand is what we want to address. And we should also hear it too. The fact that I'm telling you what you did is wrong, but you're here that, you know, doesn't mean I hate your personality. Always try to differentiate between the issues at hand and the personality. When I'm trying to correct you, not because I hate you. There's an issue I want to correct, I want to redress. So there's a difference between, you know, you confronting an issue and you confronting the personality. But some people are just trying to correct them. They think, oh, he doesn't like me. Oh, she doesn't like me. Oh, he's always... No, listen. Listen. And of course, even the time, the time matters a lot. Amen. I mean, my wife knows that, you know, she doesn't talk to me on Sunday morning to resolve a conflict. I mean, she doesn't do that. She will let me go to church and come back. Amen. And for those who are married, you know, men, when they want something, you can always, you know that time, when he wants to come and pounce on you, start talking. That's it. You know, you are not going to talk to me until you resolve this issue. I mean, there's a particular time, there's a best time. And any man will listen to you when he wants sex. You know, these are strategies. Even the women of old use to handle their home and to make their home, you know. And of course, listen, because listening involves hearing, understanding, remembering, and sometimes restating. You know, there's one, it's a two-way thing. I send you an offer, you accept my offer. Until the offer is accepted, there's no contract. So you must know, you must understand, digest what is being spoken. Don't just run berserk. You know, listening involves, effective listening involves hearing, understanding. If I'm talking, if I'm speaking, for example, you know you're hearing, but you don't understand what I'm speaking. You know, so there's a difference between hearing and understanding. You have to understand for communication to be effective. At times, communication also could be writing. My wife sent me a text message sometime ago. It took about four of my, and she was expressing herself in the text message. She just couldn't confront me, and she just felt the best is just tell this guy what you are doing is not right. And I replied. I replied and said, I'm sorry. I'm always sorry. It doesn't take me long to come sorry. It's just me. You know. So communication is not yelling at each other, it's not out talking each other. No, you are not trying to win the argument. You are trying to win your spouse. That's very, very key. You are not trying to win the argument. You are trying to win your spouse. Communication. And what are communication problems that we have? Communication killers. You know, when you're always so angry, easily angry, I mean, that could kill communication. When you are exploding, you know, because the truth is bitter. So when somebody is telling you the truth about yourself, you have to be humble to take it. So if somebody is not correcting, is a clear sign of arrogance. You know, if I can't talk to my husband, I can't talk to my wife, is a clear sign of pride. Because if I'm correcting you, the thing is hitting you. You don't like it, what I'm saying. But take it humbly. Do you know how many corrections I take in this church? You know, with my wife, it got to a point when I began to, you know, she said, I'm not going to even correct you anymore. But very soon, she can't just keep her mouth shut. But now I've learned to just raise his career. I'll just stay there. Take everything. Take all the beating. Just stay there. You know. And if I have a defense after she's speaking, I will now tell you, okay, but this is happening this way. You know, that's how to be humble. Proud people, you can't correct them. They don't take instruction. They don't take shit from no one. So if you're that kind of husband, your wife cannot talk to you. Your husband cannot talk to you. I'm sorry for you. Because anger, I mean, pride is just a step away from destruction. But that will not be your portion in Jesus' mighty name. What are communication killers? When you betray a personality, you know, some of us, I mean, now, the only person I have that is my friend is my wife. I don't have friends. All my siblings are all over the world. One is in Australia, two of them in England, the other one is in Nigeria. So I don't even see my siblings. I don't have parents anymore, I don't call my mom, there's nobody to call. So the only person I have to talk to, the only person that is my family is my wife. So if he turns her back at me, I'm in trouble. So I tell her, look, you have to forgive me because you are the only one I have, you are the only one I know. So now, because she's my wife, she has my secrets. If she's not using my secret against me when we fight, that will kill communication. And some people like that. When they fight, they not go tell you. That's how your mother, your father used to do. Your father, your mother, in secrets, they let it out when they are hungry. If you're like a person, repent. You know, lying, this will kill communication. Say you are going to my one with you, but they find you in Times Square here. You know, lying. You know, forgetfulness. Where your wife tells you something 2 weeks ago, and she's not trying to recount it, and you can't even remember. That means you're not listening. You told her you did not just hit others. You know, that's it. That's how women take these things. You know, I mean, at times my wife will tell me things that happened 5 years ago, I'll be amazed. And she will tell me details. Say, how do you remember these things for God? I can't even remember these things. But you know, once she sees it that one time, I will try to remember, I will take it into my memory. Because if she recounts again and I feign forgiveness or forgetfulness, it is trouble. You know. So this thing kills communication. When you are forgetful, when you don't listen well enough, you know, when you assume that you have told somebody something, that happens too regularly. I tell leaders in church, you see, they want to be in church, let the pastor know. You are leaders. But many of them will not tell you. They will not say, oh, pastor, I thought I told you. And you know you didn't tell me. It also happens in homes. You didn't think anything. You just didn't do what you were supposed to do, the assumption, you know, and so on and so forth. So let's make communication better, because the only way to retain our marriages is when we talk. Believe me, when a communication breaks down, marriage automatically breaks down. Amen? Conflict can be resolved. I know what you are thinking when we talk. I don't know what you are thinking when you don't talk. I have a friend that the wife packed out because the guy doesn't just talk. That was the only reason. Like, I'm not sure this guy would just want to just carry an AK-47 and blast my head. I better just go out of this one. Because the guy doesn't talk. The woman was afraid that it doesn't matter what you try to do to this guy, he just wouldn't talk. So she packed. Communication. As a matter of fact, they said it's the greatest, you know, killer to marriage. It's the greatest, you know, after which is money. Let's talk about money and then we close on this. Amen? And this is very, very sensitive. I know it. I know this is very, very sensitive. But one thing you have to know about money is this. Money is good. Let's not spiritualize it. Because money gives you options in life. When you have money, you can send your children to the best schools, you can travel, take a vacation. So when there's money in the family, somehow it's likely there's more happiness. But money itself is not happiness. Money cannot buy you happiness. Money gives you options, it can't buy you happiness. So in other words, money is not the most important thing in life. Some people value money over their relationships. Many, not even some. They value money over their wives. They value money. They love money more than their husbands. It's a fact, you know. As a matter of fact, there was an opinion poll I read, Today Matters, one of John Maxwell's book. And they said, they went out and if you have 10 million, if you are given $10 million, what are the things you would do? I mean, for you to be, they said it was an opinion poll, for $10 million, will you give up your marriage? 25% said yes, they give up their marriage for $10 million. That's one over four. So now that was 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, you know. Poor. That they will give up their money for $10 million. That's how critical money is. So don't kid yourself that money doesn't matter. Some people will pack their marriages because of money. And it's happening every day anyway. You know, people sign for notes because of money and so on and so forth. So let's just run over this and then we close. So in other words, your marriage is more important than money. Amen? Your spouse is much more important than money. And we have to be balanced about money. Yes, it is true, money answers all things. Money gives you options. But it's also true, the love of money is the root of all evils. The Bible says, some many have strayed from the faith, and they have pierced themselves through many sorrows because of the love of money. Say, man of God, say, be careful about the love of money. Say, flee the love of money. In other words, when money starts becoming a big issue in the family, it's because somebody is not Somebody loves money more than the other person. And there are many cases, there are many issues. I mean, you can be cheated, you can be, but for God's sake, even if you are cheated, God is your source. And see him as your source, and then hold on to him, and God will say to you, because money is a tool to be used, never to be worshipped. And the greatest competitor in the life of man is money. Amen? The greatest competitor of God in the life of people is money. So money is a tool to be used, never to be worshipped. In other words, there should be openness between husband and wife. For God's sake, as a husband, I should know what my wife hands. Amen?
Amen.
For God's sake, as a wife, I should know what my husband earns. I should know his take-home pay. If I don't know my wife's take-home pay, if she hides it from me, she's not a good woman. If I don't know what my husband earns, what his take-home pay is, he's not a good guy. It's as simple as that. Amen? Is as simple as that. So there should be openness to some degree in financial matters. And that you know what you are earning. And of course, people are also going into marriage. These days you have to ask, how much do you owe? You know, school loans, credit card debts. I'm telling you, you have to know. So you don't just inherit debts and for the next 5 years. So that's what you are. I'm not saying that it's not okay, but you see, let me give you a scenario. Okay, maybe somebody is owing $20,000 in credit card debts. If you didn't tell the woman she's about to get married to, and they plan a $10,000 wedding that is also credit card debt, by the time they get to the marriage, you can be sure they're going to have a hard landing. They already have $30,000 loan, credit card loan. But if this guy, if this guy had been open, maybe they would have done the wedding to that scale. And then